questionnaire.
Okay, perfect. Did you send them to me by email?
Je ne sais pas si ça peut être. Si besoin, si on a des questions, je ne sais pas.
I sent one by email.
Okay, perfect. I'll put them up as soon as they arrive.
Maybe we make them larger. Okay, nice. So let us start.
Yeah, I think we can start.
Hello, everybody. My name is Jenny Benois-Pineau, and today it's my pleasure to. I don't see the slide. Mara, I don't see the slide. Hello. Hello. No, there is a problem.
Yeah, really sorry. I think my connection just switched off. I will start sharing again. I apologize. Can you see the screen?
Yes, yes, perfect. Thank you very much. Okay, so today we will speak about attention models and saliency map and end up with the explainability of deep neural networks. And I also thank my students, Megna Ayar, and my former Mexican PhD student, Abraham Montoya Beza, for nice illustrations I will show you today. Next one, please. So, after a short introduction, our lecture is split into three main parts. First of all, we will introduce some notions of visual attention. Then, we will speak about attention in convolutional networks. And finally, move to the explanations. Okay, next one, please. So, since quite a lot of time in visual content analysis, researchers try using human attention mechanisms for essential content selection for visual mining, focusing image and video classifiers on the important regions in the input visual data, why to guide the recognition process by selective content. For this aim, they build predictive models to automatically select visual content. And we have to say that since the work by Laurent E.T. and Koch, a very large quantity of visual attention prediction models, more than 60 today, have appeared in the literature. And also today, we try to predict visual attention. But this is not about what we'll speak today. We will a little bit touch what does it mean, visual attention. And now we move to attention to DNNs. And DNNs imitate human perception of visual content. Indeed, since the model of McCulloch and Pitts, we imitate brain neurons, and of course, we imitate also visual information mining. And it is normal that attention mechanisms have been proposed also for neural networks. And today in the literature, we have quite a mix up between all these things, which is visual attention, natural attention, predicted attention, attention in the networks. And finally, today we are massively working on trustability and explainability of deep learning as a part of AI. And thus we try to identify pixels and regions in input images, which are the most important, on which the attention of the network is focused and which influence the most the network decisions. Next one, please. So let us start with some ideas about visual attention. Next one. Our eye is a very complex biological system. And in our eye, we have a full optical system, such as pupil, cornea, iris. All these are the lenses. And we have the interior of our eye, which is vitreous humor. And through this vitreous humor, the light will pass and will activate cells in the retina, and via optical nerve, it will be transmitted our light, and signals will be transmitted into the visual cortex, where we will reason and understand the visual scene. So the fovea is the central retinal part where the vision is the most accurate. And I don't see the bottom of the slide, so please, is it possible to show it? Yeah, okay. And let us see what are the receptors on the retina. Please, the next one. Our eye is the receiving sensor. And this receiving sensor contains a lot of local receivers, or we call them receptors. And two types of cells can be found. They are rods and cones. Rods are responsible for scotopic, that is night vision, and cones are responsible for photopic, daylight vision. And they react on colors. And around 120 million rod cells and 6 million cone cells are situated on retina. So here you can see a very popular image, which we find in almost all books about visual human visual system modeling, to show us how the different receptors are distributed on the retina. And here is the central visual axis, and we can see that compared to this upper figure, that we have the strongest concentration of cones here. Okay, next one, please. And our first question is, how can we capture visual attention of people when they are looking at images or at video? And the method was proposed by English researcher Wooding. He made a very large psychovisual experiment. He put eye trackers in National Gallery, and more than 5,000 participants recorded their gaze fixations on pictures. So with the eye tracker, we can record gaze fixations with a certain frequency of the subjects on the same image. And then we will inscribe a Gaussian map, a Gaussian, surface on the each gaze fixation, sum them up, normalize, and got what we call today gaze fixation density maps. Here you can see an example from our research where we showed a wearable video with the activities of people to subject to the observers, and all of them, you can see the concentration of red points, looked at the place where the person was executing some activities, and this was a task-driven psychovisual experiment. Next one, please. And thus, to build these gaze fixation density maps, to build our Gaussian surfaces, we need to know what is the Gaussian scale. And this was defined, and it is actually described in a BT50 norm, how to compute the spread of the Gaussian. So we have to know the distance between the eye and the screen, and we will compute the Gaussian scale in such a way that it reflects the projection of the retina and specifically of the fovea onto the screen where the image is displayed. And from biophysics, we know that this projection is approximately limited by 2 visual degrees. Next one, please. And here are the simple formulas how we can compute this Gaussian scale, Gaussian spread. First of all, we compute it in millimeters. Then we will compute it in screen resolution. Finally, we will transcribe a Gaussian centered at each gaze fixations, and gaze fixations are recorded by eye trackers in screen coordinates. And finally, we will sum up all these Gaussians and normalize them to scale between 0 and 1. Next one, please. And this is what we will call Saliency map. A Saliency map, or gaze fixation density map, or subjective Saliency map. All these are the same, different terms to denote the same. This is a map scaled between 0 and 1, and which shows the importance of pixels and the regions when a cohort or a single observer conducts a visual experience and observes a visual scene. And to visualize them, we use lookup tables, mapping this interval onto a color scale. And the most popular color scale is the so-called jet color map. And this color map gives the transition from blue to red. And of course, maximum value is red and lowest value, 0, is blue. Because this is a very intuitive heat map, we call it also heat map. Hot, cold, blue is cold and the red is hot. So basically, the most important will be red. Next one. Now I will show you an example of the large-scale experiment we have conducted in our laboratory, studying fixations of people in the task driving experiment when people observed images from Mexican culture. It was a big project with a National Polytechnical Institute in Mexico and the cultural archives. So here you can see in green our gaze fixations. And the number of subjects which have observed this scene was around 20, 23 exactly. And here is the eye tracker system with which the gaze fixations were recorded. And collecting all these gaze fixations in a single frame, we will get this heat map, which shows that the persons are more looking at specific details of the building. And here you can see the red heat values. Next one, please. And now we basically know how to record the attention and how to build importance maps for people when they are looking at the images. And what drives our gaze? What is the type of attention we know today? It is a very researched area, both in biophysics and computer vision, visual quality assessment, video coding, image coding. So we study everything. We study motion of the eyes, scan path. We study reaction to motion in video cases, and so on and so forth. So it could be a very big lecture about this and even several. But today what is interesting for us is two kinds, two categories, bottom up and top down. So bottom up attention, or otherwise a stimuli driving attention, expresses the attraction of a human subject by contrasts, colors, changes in orientation, local motion, all the singularities we will observe either in image or in a video scheme. And the feature integration theory proposed by Treisman and Gelati says that the human importance, the importance we assign to each region in the image, is a combination of all these stimuli-induced factors. And when we are proposing to a person just to look at the image, then at the beginning, what happens, we call this free viewing conditions, what happens is that the person will be attracted by such kind of things. And the second attention is the so-called top-down intentional attention. And this is the attention we express in a task-driven visual search, which means that the subject gets the instructions, please search for a dog in the picture, or please recognize architectural style of Mexican buildings. But our attention is never a pure bottom-up or top-down. It is a combination of both. Please, the next one. I show you here two examples. So, the experimental conditions were free viewing conditions. So the person was not instructed, we just asked him to look at the images. And here we get collected gaze fixations of 16 persons. So this is a video showing two men. And on the right, you can see the importance map, which is between 0, 1, superimposed, multiplied by pixel values. And you can see what are the areas which have the highest importance. So basically here, the person is attracted by what? He is attracted by local contrast, of course, by color contrast, but also by the fact that this is a human. And here it is attracted because we have somehow lighting conditions which makes this area brighter. And at the bottom of the picture, can we just shift a little bit our slide, please, Mara? Yes. And at the bottom of the picture, it was also a psychovisual experiment in a free viewing condition, but you can see that people foveate on the face because face is a very important semantic object. So to recognize this scene, let us imagine now, if we use purely visual attention, it will not be sufficient because we could not recognize that there is a sport hall and the person is doing some sport activities. We will only select face area. And now I will show you some other maps which were recorded with our Mexican PhD students on the Mexican database with the problem of recognition of three architectural styles. And the subjects were instructed to look at these buildings to recognize the styles. So you can see more examples of what I have shown already, that people concentrate on some specific architectural elements. Next one, please. And now the question is, we have this famous CNN classifiers for image classification tasks. And how can we use visual saliency-based attention to guide them? So it was a very, very researched subject when we worked with a bag of visual words models, when we worked with engineered features, and we even have edited a book with Patrick Le Callet, and you can find it in the references, how we tried to use different models of visual attention to select and weight features in the image. And now the problem is, how can we guide the CNN classifiers? So here we can see the so-called visual saliency-based attention block, which we have proposed. And you can see here X as input features. Then we will model attention as a probability, and an attention map is something which is external to our network. It does not generate it. It comes from outer world. And modeling it as a probability function, we will apply different pooling strategies to the locuses of different features. And we can propagate such blocks, build such blocks throughout the whole network, and each time modify our features to get X tilde features, which are based on this kind of operation. So let us see the next slide. And you can see the scheme, how we propagate visual attention maps through the network with pooling operations. First of all, when we consider a CNN, it also can be considered as a multi-scale and multi-level Gaussian pyramid. Thus, in order to fit the attention to the features which were which results from convolution, nonlinearity, and subscaling, we call it pooling in networks, we will build such a pyramid for the attention maps. Thus, we will subsample them with a factor of pooling in each layer, so we totally adapt it to the architecture of the considered CNN. And here you can see an example on an AlexNet, a very simple architecture. So we do the same subsampling and pooling, so obvious things. Okay, let us go further. And thus, we need to model these maps. And as you may understand, when we will sum up all these Gaussians, and specifically if we know that humans do not always concentrate, do not always foveate on the right object or area in the scene, that they are attracted by distractors present in the image, and thus all these gaze fixations, you have seen it in our example of verbal video, are not so much concentrated on the same part of the image, then we cannot basically apply the Gaussian assumption of our distribution. And in biophysics literature, it was shown that the Weibull distribution is well adaptable to such modeling of psychovisual experiments. So we followed this in our work, and we consider our map as a cumulative Weibull distribution. And we will also play with the parameter, because the lambda parameter defines the shape of Weibull distribution, and we will also play with this parameter and try to adapt it to the given saliency map. So we select it and compute it on the basis of a mean value of saliency map, which is always positive, as we remember, because it scales between 0 and 1. Next one, please. And thus, what we will do, on the contrary to the very, very many works which used this kind of maps, either from psychovisual experiment or from models, automatic models, to weight pixels or to weight features, we will sample them. And here you can see the source image, a beautiful building in Mexico City, Saliency map, and then with different parameters, we can see how our sampling strategy will be adapted to the value of saliency considered as a variable distribution. And in case we sample from the distribution and we binarize the map, and case the map is one, we will apply the max pooling strategy, and in case it is zero, we will apply average pooling strategy. And actually, we played with these strategies. So we know that we can have max pooling, average pooling, mean pooling, and so on and so forth. And indeed, when we do it before we consider the nonlinearity function, which will make our features positive or nearly positive, then killing completely feature values is not so good, and thus we will use average pooling to make our map more smooth. And thus, after that, we will propagate our modified feature maps as the input to the following layers of the network. Next one, please. And here you can see some results. In the data set, it is not a very big data set. It is the result of a huge work of the team in Mexico, which selected all these images from different sources, web crawling and so on, the National Archives. And to compare with the backbone, we used the ResNet 26. It is a sufficiently deep network. It is the best reported in the literature, residual optimization. And you can see how the scores change when we use this Saliency-based guidance. So basically here we have around 3% of increase of accuracies on the top one, at top one. And we have around not so many, around less than 1% on top five, but we have much less epochs. And you can imagine that the optimization, less epochs we have, better is for computational workload and also for the stability of the system. So basically, this is convincing that the network itself still can be guided by external visual attention. Next one, please. And now, external is good, but you have to compute something external. You have to modify the frameworks. And nevertheless, it requires some knowledge. So recently, about 2017, the attention mechanisms which were initially proposed for recurrent networks have penetrated to image and video classification into CNNs. And thus, in ConvNets, we also have started speaking about attention. And now we will consider global attention mechanisms. Next one, please. So today there exists a lot of papers where we read about soft attention blocks, about hard attention, about different attention things. But in my talk, I have chosen to speak about probably the first ones, and probably those on which everything is built. So the first mechanism is the global attention mechanism. And it was proposed by Shen et al. As a squeeze and excitation network. So, in the same manner as we can add any attention block after each convolutional layer in the network, we can use this squeeze and excitation block. So let us go into details. Here, X is the output of a current convolutional layer. As you know, the dimension of this tensor is WH is spatial dimension, and D is the depth, which equals to the number of filters, and number of filters is the hyperparameter of our network. So why Krzyzewski have chosen 64 filters for his first conv layer in AlexNet? Why he has not chosen 65 or 63? All these hyperparameters are fixed after some preliminary experiments and we cannot basically do real optimization of hyperparameters, optimization of architectures. People work on this, but it is still very heavy and not everybody has such computational resource. So after some preliminary experiments, or because it was published by such and such researcher, we will fix the number of filters for each convolutional layer and we will train our network. But not all the channels in all convolutional layers are equally important for the good performances of the network. So the idea of this squeeze and excitation networks is to weight channels, feature channels at each convolutional layer before the forward propagation. So this block proposes adaptive weights. And these weights are learned during training. And of course, these weights are data set dependent. We all understand that the same architecture will not perform in the same way on very different data sets. And when people started working on these convnets, I remember Rama Chalapa saying, data decides everything. And thus it is typically the case for all experience we got in our group that this is adaptable to the corpus, to the data. And this block comprises three parts. The first one is the so-called squeeze part. Then we have excitation part, and we also have scale, which is on the bottom. So how does it work? Let us look at this scheme. The idea at the beginning is very easy. We will squeeze. So reduce each map in our D maps to only one number. Thus, we will have a tensor of dimension 1 by 1 by D with the weights for each channel and some squeeze value. Let's not speak about weights now. So we will denote this vector by zeta. The second part will be excitation. So here we will train really some weights. And we will use these weights to scale features from the original output of the convolutional layer. We just will multiply each element in our matrix for all D matrices by the same value per channel, which we call the channel weight. And we will have thus a stack of weighted channels. And thus we will kill probably some non-important channels just naturally because all the values, feature values, will equal to zero. Okay, next one, please. Now let us consider the squeeze module. First of all, to get the only one value for each channel, it uses the global average pooling. So basically it computes the mean value for each channel map. Here you can see a simple computation of the mean value on one feature map. And thus, it is only one value to single importance per channel. Next step, please. And then we remember that we have the vector of mean values of features per channels. Thus, the second step is the excitation. We will not weight by mean values, but we want to get some weights which are trained during the end-to-end training process of the CNN. And thus, maybe go first to the next slide, please. Yes, thus we propose a two-layered perceptron. So the excitation function actually will take our mean value vector as the input and submit it to the MLP, in which the hidden layer has lower dimension than the input and the output layer. We remember that the dimension of these layers is D, the dimension of number of filters in our conv layer of our basic network. Okay, let us go back now. Yes, so now you understand what does it mean, W sigma and W phi. And finally, here in their work, it was the ReLU function, which still remains the most popular, which was used. And a nonlinearity, such as sigmoid activation, the second nonlinearity was proposed to the output layer of our perceptron. And we can play with this perceptron because one of the hyperparameters of this squeeze and excitation network becomes the the reduction ratio parameter. How shall we reduce, let's say, the number of channels? Okay, so of course, the full optimization is very costly, and the authors report on several trials where they have some numbers for their data set, but we will have to play for our data set with this, how it is dependent on the data set and what is the optimal value. We do not know. Unfortunately, in many papers on deep neural networks, we do not get exhaustive studies and let's say indications how to set such or such parameter. Okay, next one, please. Yes, and thus we have seen this perceptron, and the next one, please. And the output of squeeze model is a tensor of size 1/1/d, and we will just scale our features as if we applied the importance weights to each channel, and we do it uniformly for each feature in the given channel. We assign the same weight and do this scalar matrix multiplication, and we get the modified feature vector. And thus, we can add these attention blocks. Actually, in our practice, we played with very various numbers of attention blocks, and sometimes once more I say that it is data set dependent, but from our experience, you are not obliged to put them after each convolutional layer. Someone would be sufficient for your data set. Next one, please. Thus, you know that from literature and from our experiences, not always. ResNet is reported is the best performing architecture. And you know the principle that the optimization is done for residual of features. And here is the typical ResNet block where we have the input from previous layer and it is added to the optimized here computed features. And if we have this squeeze and excitation stuff, then we can include it into here. This was reported in the paper of the people who has proposed this method. And also they used the so-called ResNet extended blocks, which means that instead of a simple ResNet block, you recognize it from here, right? They parallelized with different numbers of filters in this chain, okay? And they report some results on this ResNet with squeeze and excitation and on ResNet XT. Please, the next one. Yeah. Here we have some results. And if this computational mechanism is of low cost, it depends. If we apply to all the layers, convolutional layers in a very deep network, then of course it will cost something. But basically between squeeze such as mean pooling of mean global pooling and two-layered perceptron with reduced number of inputs, if we don't have very many filters for this, then it is not so costly. And after applying this mechanism for the network in ILS VRC in 2017, they got the first place. And you can see here some figures. You remember 224 by 224. This is the figures of cropping from AlexNet by Gershik and Krizhevsky. And here for the top five error, there was a reduction which makes them the first. And we can observe the same order of reduction of the error for a little bit larger crops from images. So definitely it increases the capacity. Okay, next one, it increases the accuracy, sorry. Now, this idea is very, very much seducing because we can say that even if we parameterize over dimension, the number of filters in each convolutional layer in our architecture, then with the help of this squeeze and excitation, we can basically kill some layers. And then analyzing the network performance during the time, we can reduce and get the optimal architecture. So let us see our experiments, some of our experiments on this. We are actually working now on the basis of the big interest of our community for helping people recognize COVID and grading COVID. And recently, in Nature Scientific Reports, there was the so-called COVIDNet architecture proposed for classification of COVID or healthy subject, normal control, or pneumonia using X-ray images. And when we are saying about X-ray images, these are not CT images, which are very detailed and allow, give the doctors good tool for recognizing typical patterns. On X-ray images, it is much more difficult. And even speaking with medical doctors who exercise in France, they say not, it is not possible. But X-ray is much cheaper than CT examination of a patient. This is why in countries where the situation with the global health and funding, specifically the healthcare, is not so good as in developed European countries, then there is a nice attempt, and it was reported in Nature Scientific Reports, to try to do it with X-rays. But as medical doctors have difficulties, and we can ensure screening, massive screening of the population with portable X-ray devices, then of course automatic classification. And they proposed a convolutional network, which is called COVIDNet, and it is composed of the so-called PEPX blocks, which means the projection and extension. And PEPX block is a block exactly like this. So here we have one by one convolutions. Then we have in depth 3x3 convolution, and once more one by one. And that's it, the block and this block are one after another until we get to the fully connected layer. And here they use three layers, and finally softmax for the decision in the classification of the patients. Next one, please. So here is the database which we have constituted from different publicly available X-rays in COVIDNet initiative. It is open database. And after cleaning, we come to some images are different, but we come to the same database as they report in the Nature report. So as all medical databases, it is not very much populated. It is not an image net, of course. And thus we perform binary classification tasks. So in the binary classification in medical images, the objective, the goal of binary classification is to isolate normal control class. So here we show you some results of the binary classification between normal and COVID class. Next one, please. And these are the results compared with the squeeze and excitation block and added to a well-known ResNet 50 and Inception V3 compared to so-called COVIDNet, which was claimed to perform best than all these networks. And you can see that if we add squeeze and excitation block to the plain ResNet 50 or to the plain Inception V3, then we already have better or equal figures, right, then we have with this complex COVIDNet, which is so-called a tailored network. Thus, the conclusion is that take a simple network with a sufficient depth and then apply squeeze and excitation and take all the parameters which are reported in the literature, so hyperparameters on layers, and you will get similar results and even a little bit better. But, you know, before we claim that on medical images we have better results. We need to do a lot of experiments, cross-validations, several trials, and then verify the statistical consistency of this better. But for the moment, it is like this. So squeeze and excitation blocks can help in optimizing our networks after we have already fixed all hyperparameters. Next one, please. And now let us speak about double attention mechanisms with local attention. So as we already understand, what is attention? Visual attention of people. What is visual attention of people? It is the foveation of some areas in the image, locally. And even more, we have also all which is inhibited. We cannot foveate at the same time to close spatial details. This is also biophysics. And networks try to imitate this attention. So how we will weight or emphasize each local feature in feature channels in convolutional layers? This is the question. Next one, please. And so, one of the also most popular attention mechanisms, which allows this local attention allocation, is the double attention block, double attention mechanism of Shen and Kalantinidis. So, what they say that these mechanisms capture long-range feature interdependencies. That we will work on the entire tensor of our output features from previous convolutional layer. So you can see it as X. And once more, D is the number of filters in applied, the number of channels in this layer. And double attention block comprises two major stages. The first one is the so-called feature gathering. It selectively gathers key features from the entire space. And what is entire space? It is both spatial and, let's say, D-axis. So we will select not only the most important channels, but also local features. And the second one is feature distribution, which adaptively distributes a subset of key features on the input features. So always here we have this direct connection between our input features. Then we will add something and we will get our modified features. So what happens here? The first block will compute the softmax on our features, so transform it into 0, 1, into a kind of attention stack, I will call it. They call it attention maps. And it will do exactly the same operation, but as in the whole training process, we train the weights in these blocks, the weights will not be the same, and we will get the softmax of another convolution, and we will get the so-called attention vectors. And finally, we will combine all this in feature gathering and bilinear interpolation between different channels, and finally feature expansion. So let's go further. Yeah. I'm always fascinated as a person who comes from signal processing, how in computer vision papers, fundamental notions are denoted. So here, phi, gamma, delta are the convolution operations. And these are the different convolutions operations denoted by different, because we want to separate between different steps. Okay, let us do it. And the attention pooling they propose is the so-called second order. Why? If we do a mean pooling in one slice, what can we say? That this is the first order. We compute the first order moment of our statistical value, which is the value of features in the given map. If we would like to compute the variance, or we would like to compute just the square of the features, we will say that we compute the second order statistic on them. And they call their model second order attention pooling, because actually they will use the cross correlation between two different channels. So basically we will have the maps A and the map B. And our X is the tensor of the dimension WHD. Then we will do some dimension reduction. You see here, this dimension reduction is done with a convolution operation, okay, with weights phi. And this phi also expresses convolution, as they say, but basically I think it is a more combination of convolution and pooling, subsampling. And here we will do the softmax operation on the same, which is a convolution. This is an end by one by one by one convolution, so just a multiplication by the scalar of each feature. Then we will do softmax, and then we will do the so-called bilinear pooling. So these dimensions will not be the same of A and B, because in B we do not have dimensionality reduction. And this is expressed here by these formulas, A equals to the vector. Unfortunately, I cannot show you my mouse, but you will believe me. So on the left, more on the bottom, we can see, yes, that A and B are not of the same dimension. And we will compute the product of these matrices and get on the right here in the bottom, get the matrix and the tensor of the dimension M by N, and each this matrix can be considered as a set of n vectors of dimension m. So between two transformations, it gives a kind of correlation. And thus, we will take these gathered features and transmit it to the feature distribution block. And in feature distribution block, what we see? We see our input, which is multiplied by scalars. So we have here convolution, then once more softmax, and we will call these vectors, and we will multiply these vectors by, we call it them attention vectors, of course, here softmax and here softmax, so between 0 and 1, importance, and we will multiply by this matrix, and finally go to the dimension extension also with a convolution, and upsampling to get the same dimension of the tensor as the input tensor. And here, element-wise summation. Next step, please. So, why double attention? Because at the first block, we will get the attention map and we will do the bilinear pooling with the propagated features A. And the second block also in feature distribution, it will also use the softmax and thus second attention mechanism. And here we have just the computation of attention vectors as a softmax. And finally, it gives attention for distribution. We saw that we will multiply them, so we will somehow put an importance to these bilinearly interpolated features. And finally, the distribution here, we will get G bilinear multiplied by our attention vectors. Next one, please. Previous. It was just one. Yeah, thank you very much. And here in blue, on the right, here on the blue, we have the dimension extension. And as I said, it was also is done with the trainable weights. And we add. So sometimes we will express this like just multiplication of our vector x by 1 plus this stuff, plus some weight from here. And basically, it reminds me a lot the age enhancement operation in fundamental image processing when we take pass band filter and we sum up original pixel values with the response of pass band filter. So basically, this gives the same. It reinforces some features. But the only difference is that all this is done in the global training process. So all the reinforcement is targeted to increase the accuracy or to decrease the loss function. Next one, please. Yeah, here we can see some results. On ImageNet with 1K concepts, the baseline was ResNet. Then squeeze and excitation gave a little bit better results on top 5. If we consider reasonable ResNet 50. And double attention blocks, A2net, gave just insignificant, very small improvement. So the idea is nice. The idea is to reinforce features locally in each channel and also through the channels. But the result is not so convincing. Then, what is also important, it is computational cost. And another comparison was done on the kinetics data set. Kinetics is video. It is about action recognition. And they used only RGB information for the input, so no motion, no motion vectors, nothing. And here we have a little bit better results specifically compared to I3D, which we know well, Cicerman's work, which used both RGB and optical flow, but in this case they used only RGB. So compared to LSTM and convolutional, then the increase of percentage is quite nice. Okay, so the authors report that such models work better with top layers of the network, that is close to the classification layer, and the experiments on ImageNet show that adding multiple blocks improves performance. It also works better than SOA for 3D CNNs, for video representations for RGB information. Hence, in our work, we also use something similar, inspired by the double tensor block, and indeed in 3D ConvNet, it also improves the performance about a few percent. Next, please. And now let us compare how it is different or is the same if we do not use an internal mechanism of the network, but push external attention as we described through the network. And here we once more consider the problem of classification of architectural styles. No, here it is the buildings. So we had more categories. We had around 60 categories here. And also used the attention maps, visual gaze fixation density maps. And this is reported in the last row. So SA means saliency attention, human visual attention. Then we can see what? That compared to all others, a top one, humans are still the most performant, because if we take their visual gaze fixation density maps, then we will get very nice difference of something about 5%. And 5% compared to ResNet 26 with A2. I compare 88.0.2 with 93.0.6. So, and 5% is not 0.5% as reported in previous works with automatic network attention. On top five, the difference is less perceivable. And also what we can say that for some configurations of the ResNet, which means here on the plus one block column, you can see at what blocks were after what blocks were added attention blocks, or in which blocks were added attention blocks, because you know the visual attention blocks are added into the block itself. And you can see that when we use only one block, then we train the network quicker. But the quickest training is, of course, with A2, still 2% almost lower than our results. Okay, next, please. So, what about our maps? We have seen gaze fixation density maps, which are used to stress the features throughout the layers. You have seen the softmax made maps, which also stress the features by networks themselves, by trained weights through the layers. And now we have the inverse problem. We have already pre-trained network. And now we want to see the map which will highlight the pixels in the image which have contributed the most in the decision of the network. Let's go. We speak about explanations. But I will skip the introduction and just say a few words of taxonomy. By the way, if you want to read a little bit more in detail, then our paper is on archive and submitted to Journal of Electronic Imaging. You can go here, the reference is there. So today we studied a bit, it is not a new subject for many of us, and we studied a lot. We got an overview of current works in the community, making a workshop in ICPR conference, and we come to the following taxonomy, that we have black box based methods. We have structure based methods, approximation of DNN classifiers. These are the earliest works. And recently adversarial based. So basically we are interested a lot in the structure based methods. So I will focus on them, but we'll say some few words about black box principles because they are quite funny. Let's go. Next one, please. So these methods are also called perturbations-based methods. Next one, please. And the principle is very simple. So let us take a trained network. And then let us push through this network an image in which we systematically mask some regions. So we induce a perturbation or occlusion by some region. And then let us see how the score, the classification decision evolves. And in this way, we will find regions which are relevant for the network. And we will explain for this given image why the network has decided in such a way. Next one, please. And here also it is the method which was proposed by Ziller and Fergus, and the idea is also inclusion, of course, but what is interesting that they have proposed a deconvolutional neural network. In their propagation back to the image, they will do a deconv operation. So look, here we have the convnet, classical convnet, and we got the convolutional layer with features coming from convolutional layer. These are the feature maps. Then we push them through the nonlinearity, which is ReLU in this case. We can get the rectified feature maps, and we will get pooled map with max pooling standard stuff for 2014 about AlexNet and propagate further to 2018. to the fully connected and decision layer. And here we do the back propagation. And we will take the layer above reconstruction. So basically, we will start with the last convolutional layer, which is before the fully connected layer. And we will do unpooling. And to do unpooling, we will have to modify a little bit the network in order to save the binary maps, which will retain the position of maximum, because obviously in this 2014 we have a max pooling. Then we will apply ReLUCH in order to ensure the positivity of the features, and we will do the convolution with the filters we call FT. And this is actually the process of deconvolution, because in their work they show that the transposed filter, what if you train a filter mask, then the transposed mask is just the reverse filter, that we will get the original from this filtering of features. And finally, masking in different places, they will build the importance map. Next one, please. So here are some examples. And this method is easy to implement, but it is slow to perform because we have to mask several regions. In this, you see that we have to scan somehow the image with different sizes of windows and the different ratios if we want to be more precise. And it is long to implement, but still an elegant idea. Next one, please. And now we will see the methods by approximation of DNN classifiers, please. And the very popular one is the gradient backpropagation. So we put vanilla because, you know, when you go to the different GitHubs to get these methods, they are all implemented. Then this one is called vanilla gradient backpropagation. The idea here is the following. It is one of the earliest work because it was as early as in 2013 as Simonian, Vidaldi and Cicerman tried to show what were the pixels which activated the decision for the given class of image. And the idea is the following here. SC of I is the score function, and it is a function of I. Then, if we consider the first order Taylor approximation with regard to some image point, let's say data point in the image space, which we denote I0, then it can be expressed by this formula, where our W are the derivatives of the scores accordingly to the images computed at this point, initial point. So initial point should be a kind of image. And to get these weights, they take the network, and they do a single back propagation pass till the input layer with the gradients. And thus, after rearranging all these weights, they will get the map, which they call the class Saliency map. And they will get on RGB image, superimpose on this RGB image, they will superimpose the maximum of weights per channels and accumulate them. So here we can see some examples, and I hope you can see that we have some masks, a kind of masks here, which expresses this importance of the pixels for the classification. So the next one, please. But also, when we are speaking about gradient computation, we are all aware that if we have noise in the data, then the high pass operation as gradient derivation will amplify this noise. And thus, there was another method which was proposed, and it is called integrated gradients. And thus, we consider our network as a function, as a mapping from Rn to the interval 0, 1. Our final probabilities are all in this interval. And we consider some image, which is called baseline image. And as a baseline image, when we have no knowledge what should be this baseline image, it is usual initialization by zero, and zero means absolutely black image for CNNs. And input image is, of course, a color image something. And thus, we will compute the gradients moving from this baseline image to our current image and integrate little by little on this alpha. So basically take our image, multiply by alpha, and take the difference with zero. Then move alpha from zero to one, and then you will get several images like this, and you can compute integrated gradients like this. So the hope is that they will be less noisy. Next slide, please. And the integrated gradients give such kind of maps. Either they are better than simple gradient backpropagation. Visually, we cannot say. We have to compute the matrix between saliency maps, between heat maps, to see how they are different and what is their quality. Generally speaking, the question of quality of explanations is an open question, and we have to resort to user studies in this case, but still have a look at these maps. Next one, please. Now let us speak about structure-based methods. Next one, please. So, one of the most popular method is the so-called grad-cam. Yes, we have our output. This is Y. And we have our feature maps of the last convolutional layer. And thus, the principle is to compute the gradients of our scores accordingly to the feature maps of last convolutional layers. And basically, the authors say that the gradient transfers information from class decision to spatial features. Indeed, what were the features which have contributed the strongest into the class decision? And this is also the method with the back propagation. So we have the function of scores for the given class, we have the size of last convolutional layers, and we have activations, and we use the classification layer before softmax, and we will backpropagate and compute the gradients of feature maps. Next one, please. And also, for each gradient, we will calculate the weights for feature channels to build the final heat map. And these weights are computed as global average pooling of gradients obtained via back propagation. One of the variants of this method is the so-called guided grad count. In this case, they will consider only positive gradients. They will annihilate all negative gradients. And in this sense, the mean value makes sense. Otherwise, it can be quite close to zero. And thus, we will have the global average pooling of gradients, and for each channel, we'll have its weight. And the final weight will be a final heat map, importance map at this last convolutional layer, will be positively transformed by ReLU, linear combination of feature maps, then activation, it is a feature, resulting feature of the whole convolution pooling nonlinearity cycle. And we will weight it by integrated gradients on the channel. And their dimension, the resolution of this importance map will be the same as the feature map of the last layer. Okay, next one, please. And the definition, the identification better of pixels which have contributed the most is realized by interpolation and upscaling of last layer, last convolutional layer map until the initial resolution of our image. And here you can see an example. This is the original image. This is the grad cam which was applied in the case of category cat, when the network given the result cat. And you can see we have both dog and cat in the same image. And this is the grad cam which visualized this importance map on the head of the dog when the classification was dog. Okay, the next one, please. And probably in one of the previous lectures, you have already studied the method of layer-wise relevance propagation. Is this the case?
No, we haven't touched the layer-wise relevance propagation, just mentioned it.
Okay. So this is the method which was recently proposed by the team of Samik, and you know his book about explainable AI. And the idea here is the following. The prediction on the unseen data of our network is decomposed as relevance scores. So in the last layer, each neuron will be responsible for one class, right? And our network is a function which propagates our features, our input, until the last layer and gives the strongest response for the class, one of the classes. And the principle, if we take softmax at the end, softmax layer, then we can say that the sum of all softmaxes equals to one. And instead of speaking about probability, they speak about relevance. And they consider the principle of relevance conservation. They say that if we make the sum at according two neurons, using two neurons at each layer of the network, then the sum will be constant. And this is the principle of relevance conservation through the network. And finally, what happens? We try to redistribute relevance, starting from the output layer, and propagate layer by layer until we reach the input layer, until we reach our axis, which means until we reach our pixels. Okay, the next one, please. So here it is, the illustration. We have, let's say, one neuron, and one neuron has its own activation. Then the activation of the previous neuron multiplied by the weight, all them will contribute into, okay? And they propose that the relevance, if we take two neurons, J and K, in two consecutive layers, then the relevance of the neuron J can be computed during the backpropagation process from the relevance of the neuron K. And not only this neuron, but all the neurons which are connected to RJ by this formula. Here we have neuron activations in the forward pass. And here we have the weights on the synaptic connections. And this rule is called LRP1, oh, zero, sorry, LRP0. Okay, so we compute all other connections and divide by this. Next one. But obviously, if our neurons hire very small values, higher, then we can have some numerical instability. And this is why they propose the second rule, which is epsilon rule. Epsilon is small positive, just to prevent the numerical instability. And starting from the same principle, they also propose the gamma rule. And in the gamma rule, they will separate positive weights and negative weights. And this parameter gamma can regulate the contribution of positive weights. I would not say that it is somehow mathematically proven, but the group reports on most stable explanations, which are less disturbed by small image variations. Okay, the next one, please. And this is some results they report in their paper of 2019 for three rules: LRP zero, LRP epsilon, and LRP gamma. What is common in these maps? The LRP method, and it is not only on this example, on this kind of images, but we also stated it on a subset of ImageNet experimentally, let's say, we will get the same stuff. It explains the decision for the network by strong contrast, local contrast. It shows an importance map as if the recognition was only due to the strong local details. I'm not sure that it is true, because when we are doing usual pooling process in any network, then little by little we will totally remove all high frequency features, small details in the images, as the first layers of convolutional networks, accordingly to my experience and visualization of a lot of features, shows that for AlexNet, for instance, the first layers act as low pass filters. And finally, if only these contour points have contributed into the final decision, not so sure, but relevance propagation principle, relevance conservation principle gives such results. I don't know if amongst you have people who studied it very attentively. I would like to listen to their opinion very much. Okay, next slide, please. In our work, we proposed also an explanation method, which we call FEM, feature explanation method, or feature understanding method. And the principle is the following. As in GradCam or guided GradCam, we consider the features of the last convolutional layer just before the fully connected layer. What is fully connected layer? We take convolutional layer in any network, we flatten it to one-dimensional vector and submit it to a multi-layered perceptron. In the worst case, it is a simple perceptron without hidden layers. Or sometimes we will have two or three hidden layers. It depends on on the architectures, right? So the idea is that if you submit something which is totally zero, and the convolutional layers act as feature extractors. So propose a flat image, totally flat image. What will be the features at the end? I think that the answer is they will be black stuff, black image. So then whatever weights you will give, you will not get good classification results in such kind of images. But and practice shows this, because low contrasted images, if you classify, you train, you have more mix, less performance than using the result, the same architecture, the same hyperparameter optimization method, gradient, step, Descent step strategy, and all this stuff. On the colored images with the details, you will get better performances. And thus, for us, what is important is the features of last convolutional layers. And we will play with them. So we will play in the sense that in each channel, we will isolate, we take them after ReLU nonlinearity, so they are all positive. And we will play with them and isolate rare events. We suppose that in a visual scene, we cannot have very many important contours or important details, and that the strongest features will be on these important details in the image. And thus, we will suppose Gaussian distribution. Of course, everybody understands that it is not Gaussian because we have positive features after really no linearity, but still, if we have a long dimension, then reasonably can suppose that we have a Gaussian with non-zero mean. And we will filter out all features accordingly to a simple statistical K sigma rule. And we will take the Q of the distribution, the positive, the highest Q of the distribution, and mark only these features and say these are important features. Now, how can we propagate them? Basically, it is a binary operation, thresholding, right? And we do not know which channel is the most important and less important. So we will use some weighting, which is inspired by squeeze and excitation network. So we take only the first step, we squeeze each channel using global average pooling, just computing the mean. Here you can see the vectors, squeeze. And we will weight our maps, channel, binary channel maps, by these mean values. Once more, they are positive as we act after ReLU. Next one, please. Yeah. And here is the scheme. So the upper branch is our network. Then we take last convolutional layers, we'll do filtering, get binary feature maps. We will compute important weights by simple squeeze operation, average pooling, weight these maps. We will get the weighted binary maps. Then we will squeeze all channels together. It will be just a linear combination of our maps, and normalize between 0 and 1, upscale to the size of original image, and get the importance map. Now, what is the quality of the explanation method? How well it explains? It is a very good question, as we already said, because who is the final consumer of this explanation. It is a human. We do not explain our network for a robot or something. It is a human. The human has to be satisfied. How to objectively measure human satisfaction? Our proposal is, if the explanation maps correlates with gaze fixation density map, the human we measured with a bunch of humans who looked at the same image, then we can say that the explanation method is good. It is also questionable, but this is our position. Otherwise, we will have to involve the users and ask them if this explanation is good for them or find some other criterions. But today we don't have a consensus in the community. Next one, please. First of all, some visual example. We applied to LRP and FEM to explain the decisions of a classification with a shallow 3D convnet on the brain. And the problem was the classification of Alzheimer's. So the region you can see here is the hippocampal area and it shrinks. So basically the problem is classification was normal control subject and Alzheimer's subject. So once more binary classification, medical case. So here is the importance map with FEM. And here is the importance map with LRP. What we can see that LRP gives strong, these are some slices of the projection. We took one sagittal projection of this 3D image and you can see maps on the slices. So LRP is faithful to itself. It shows important stuff, important pixels on the borders of the hippocampal, and that's it. And our method is more holistic, and you can see that here the whole hippocampal area is highlighted. Okay, so what is the way human expert will examine, visually analyze a picture to get the response in his visual task, diagnostics in this case? Will he follow the contour or will he got some holistic approach? I don't think that the first is hold. Next, please. And thus, trying to objectivize a bit these comparisons, we use the standard metrics for comparing of attention maps. For instance, if you have two attention mechanisms, local attention mechanisms in a DNN, we can compare the importance weights, importance of this importance weights we get for the whole maps using this matrix, because this matrix are proposed by psychovisual community for comparison of gaze fixation density maps and all predicted maps, all generated maps. Thus, we did not use everything. I do not report it here, but we used. The first is the similarity, which is simply the intersections considering the importance maps as the distributions. And the second one is Pearson correlation coefficient. Yes. The next one, please. And here is an experiment we conducted on the MexCulture 142 data set, which is now publicly available on Nakala server and CNRS. So I invite you to experiment on it. There we have all the gaze fixation available. Using Wooding method, we will build, yes, and the psychovisual experiment, the distance to the screen was normalized. There are some rules to respect. We respect it. So you can use Wooding method to compute gaze fixation density maps, and then compare explanation maps in terms of this matrix with gaze fixation density maps. And so here we show the results of three vanilla backpropagation, grad-cam, and you can see that if we consider the similarity matrix, then our method is a little bit better, a little bit better, with the same variance. Then, if we consider, and we did it for different networks, and basically, for SNET 50, vanilla backpropagation is better, but for VGG, which are not ResNet networks, so basically, our method correlates more. So the correlation coefficient is also somehow a little bit higher with approximately the same variance, 0.1 of difference on the variance, so not so many. For shallow networks and for non-ResNet networks, it is better. So basically, for ResNet 152, I don't think it is reasonable to do it, but when you have a very thorough students, and it was the case of Azif, they will push the experience to the very end without knowing why they are doing this. So here's the table. But still, we can say that feature explanation method is not bad at all, because sometimes, and specifically in normalized scan path saliency, it is another specific metric for comparison of gaze fixation density maps, it is quite better. And on VGG network and in PCC, you compare, it is quite a difference with grad-cam and close to vanilla backpropagation. So basically, this is the mean for the comparison of different networks, of the explanations in terms of producing of importance map on the original visual data. Next one, please, and I will finish. So in conclusion, I have presented you today a kind of overview, starting from the modeling of human visual attention, but based on measures on the humans, that the goal, our final goal, is always to be selective in visual content, which part of this visual content to submit to the classifier, to the network in our case, to get the most robust and the most accurate result. That we can use visual attention guidance external to the networks, and I really think that it is better than all attention mechanisms, at least in our experiences for top-down visual task, and which is complex, and on quite a representative data set. But the difference is not very big. Deep CNNs are nearly as attentive as humans, speaking literally, in terms of performances with attention model and without them. But still, we believe that, and the figures show that humans do better. And attention models in CNNs are not yet at the very stable situation of research. We have heard about transformers. So I have not worked personally with transformers, but also these new tools are based on attention mechanisms. And the relation between explanation of the network and the attention inside the network still has to be further explored, in my humble opinion. So thank you very much for your attention. Do you have questions, please?
Hi, Jenny. Thank you very much. This was really interesting. I will first leave the word to the other people. If any one of the students has a question, feel free to ask. Otherwise, I have a question myself. Yeah, I see Romain raised his hand. Romain, is there something you want to say? Please go ahead.
Yes, thank you very much. Thank you very much, Jenny, for this presentation. I have a question regarding GradCam, and I believe your technique as well. When you have this activation map, which is on the size of the feature map, which is smaller than the original image, and then you're doing some upsampling to get back to the size of the original image. Mm-hmm. Isn't the underlying assumption is that there's some kind of one-one relationships between the input pixels and the output feature? Like if we could apply the same grid that we have on the feature space on the original image. But I've seen some papers where the receptive field of the of these deep CNN that you're using are actually very big. And it's almost sometimes covering the entire image, but just shifted a little bit. So isn't just a simple upsampling maybe a limitation of the technique?
Yeah, you ask a good question. First of all, of course, if the pooling in the network is very strong from layer to layer to layer to layer, then we will get a very large area at the input image, which corresponds to only one important feature. And this is the problem. This is the problem, what I call the resolution of the method of the GradCam and of ours. And this is why today we are working on the kind of backpropagation, which is based on some kind of the ideas of LRP, but without the relevance conservation hypothesis. It is basically founded on my experience in multi-resolution image and video analysis. We want to increase the resolution of our method. So I hope that in 6 months, I will be able to say you more. Okay?
Okay, thank you very much.
Are there any other questions?
Yes, if you wish the support, I can send you in the chat, right? I can send a shareable link. I put them onto the Google Drive. Just a moment. Please try.
Jenny, do you want me to upload this link on the website as well, so that it would be accessible also from the website?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay. I will do so then. Maybe I can ask a question as well. So I was wondering, in your method, you weight, you apply this weighting based on squeezing the individual feature maps. I was wondering, what is the difference between the weighting function that you apply in your method and the weighting function that is applied in GradCam or CAM methods. Because, you know, so in GradCam, mostly in CAM, there is a global average pooling operation of the feature maps.
Mm-hmm. But it is the same.
Okay.
It's exactly the same.
Okay. And so, as a follow-up question, I was wondering if you have a visual comparison of the activation maps obtained with your method and the GradCam method. So I've seen here in the table, sorry if I take the I go down. Yeah, so I've seen here in the table you have a evaluation of GradCam and the method in terms of the similarity. I'm wondering if you also had a visual comparison, if you had done it.
Yeah, yes, in visual comparison, we did, but no, we did not grade visual comparison on Likert scale or something like this. But we actually compared also the, it is not here, but we compared also the maps between GradCam, guided GradCam, our method, and the vanilla propagation. And our method is very close to guided GradCam. The closest one is guided GradCam. And guided GradCam, we will preserve only positive gradients, right? And they are very similar. And this similarity is due to two facts. The first one is that they all interpolate until the original resolution, because they use the features from the last layer only, or last conv layer. So we interpolate the maps, so they are somehow fuzzy on the original input, right? Yes, and the second one is that here it uses positive gradients, guided GradCam, and we use positive features. Yeah, I think so.
I see Romain is asking in the chat if you have results with integrated gradients instead of vanilla gradients.
No, we did not compare with integrated gradients. Yeah, if I have chance and Meghna will stay with us, we will do this. If I don't have chance, I don't know if we will compare with vanilla with the integrated gradients.
And if there is still time, maybe for a last question, I might ask you. You talked about this idea of a resolution issue of the activation maps that you obtain as an explanation method, and I was also wondering if this is connected to the size of your input, because if we were thinking of downsampling the input image and downsampling the input image, this input image reduces in size, and as the image that we input reduces in size, the explanation power of the method that we're using also reduces.
Yes, you are right. You are perfectly right. Because look, if we take HD images, right, or 4K images from our mobile
phone,
and then we push it through the network in which we have 20 or 40 or something pooling, then none of them, GradCam, guided GradCam, our method will not be sufficient, because they, as our colleague from CR said, he pointed the method that only one feature will correspond to a huge receptive field on the original input. And you know what? When we did the classification with of the brain images with a quite shallow 3D convnet, it is a little bit kind of AlexNet, but in 3D, right? So we had to remove one pooling layer in order to get good explanation, because otherwise we had the spread almost on the whole image.
Yes, yes, I've seen the same thing on histopathology images, and the risk there is that aren't we creating methods that look like we would expect them to look like? And I think you have a key there that is using human attention as a comparison, because otherwise we're kind of forcing a structure that might just come from our prior assumptions, and might this might be too strong.
Yes, yes.
Okay, thank you very much. This was very interesting, and I wish, I mean, if anyone else has follow-up questions, you can send them to me or directly to Jenny. We can try to continue this discussion because it was really interesting, but I wouldn't keep this going longer because we're already 16 minutes later than what we expected. Yes. So I would like to thank you, Jenny, very much, and thank you all of you. And yeah, so...
And thank you, Mara, for organizing and talking. It is a very challenging and interesting work. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.